drink.
Oh, thank you, brother.
Wanna get rich?
I don't need that, brother.
Wanna fool around?
Oh, thank you, sister. Ain't you heard that old evil man within me dies? No, I ain't going.
Well, what you gonna do, man?
I'm gonna keep on praying and keep working out my salvation. Trying to get sanctified. There is no more condemnation. Jesus brought salvation.
Yeah.
Justification brought me safely to his side. And as I get to know him more, he gives me a taste of the coming glory. And I'm working out my salvation, trying to get sanctified, sanctified,
sanctified,
sanctified. Yes, I'm working out my salvation, trying to get sanctified.
Don't go to church.
Yes, I'm going.
Why are you that old brother?
Cause I like it.
Well, brother, God bless you.
You know, you ain't got no argument for what I feel inside.
Let's have a little fun.
That's what I'm having.
Life's gonna pass you by.
I can hardly wait. I got my mind set on eternity. Trying to get sanctified. There is no more condemnation. Jesus brought salvation. Justification brought me safely to his side. And as I get to know him more, he gives me a taste of the coming glory. And I'm working out my salvation, trying to get sanctified. Sanctified.
Everybody, let's go on into the Word, chapter 15 of Genesis. Let's get there. We're going to talk about the covenant. The covenant, the God of covenants, the God who comes and meets us.
Amen. Yes. Yes, yes he does.
Yes. He makes a mark. But God is never going to demand something from us that he doesn't demand of himself. That he has not already shown us and revealed to us.
Chapter 15.
When you get there, give a hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. And we just thank the Lord. We thank the Lord for today. I thank the Lord for giving me an unction to speak today.
Yes.
And to give me this word. This is a precious word to everybody. It's been on my mind for about a month or so now. It's just been kind of giving me more and more, and I just want to share with you. And I think it's relevant to the message we've heard from Sister Cherie and Kathy, and just the songs we've been hearing today in the Lord. The spirit of unity is trying to send us a message today. The Lord is really speaking today, and if you'll just listen with your spiritual ears. Abraham was considered a great man of faith, but not without his faults. Abraham is the father of many nations. Abraham is the father of the Israelites. When God revealed himself to Moses, he said, "I am the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob." He is that beginning covenant with God. God looked upon Abraham and seen something special in Abraham.
Yes.
And he knew that there was hope for humanity. There was hope and a cause that he could live by and that he could work through. He could work through this set of people whom he foreknew from the beginning. Yes. He could work through this group of people, despite their failures and their faults, he can still work through them.
Yes.
Come on.
Not in spite of them, but through the mistakes and the failures.
Yes.
Because he foreknew, because he is the beginning and the end. He knows the beginning.
Okay.
He knows the end. He set it in motion. See, God is not just a God that has done something and left us to our vanity, left us to our wickedness. He's ever present. He's a personal force
Amen.
In our life. And he wants to inform us and give us knowledge and wisdom to carry out his blessing in the
yes.
earth. He wants to keep informing us and keep giving us wisdom and knowledge. And the deeper and deeper you go into that, the deeper and deeper you sink into God, the deeper
yes.
and deeper knowledge and wisdom you can have
Come
to
on.
Lead
yes.
a tribe,
Come
to
on.
Lead a nation, to
Amen.
Lead a people into a greater place of understanding, into a greater place of serenity and peace that God gives by his Spirit.
Yes.
Not
yes.
by us, but by the Spirit,
yes.
saith the
somebody.
Lord. Not by us, but by the Spirit,
yes.
saith the
somebody.
Lord.
Yes. Yes.
Not by the flesh, but by the Spirit.
Yes.
But I tell you, brothers and sisters,
Amen.
there is a change
yeah.
that will take place in the physical and in the spiritual.
Yes.
Because
yes.
they are a reflection of each other.
Yes.
They are a reflection. If you think you see a change in the spiritual, but you're not experiencing something in the physical, there's something wrong. You're not
yes.
you're not a reflection
yes.
of what God wants you to
yes.
be. You're
yes.
not changing exactly
yes.
how he wants you to change.
Amen.
You're not moving in the direction he wants you to move.
Yes.
You can have a heart change. You can have the power of God. You can say, I feel it all day long. But if you're not moving in that direction and
yes.
your scenery's
Come
not changing,
on.
Then you're not moving the way God wants you to move.
Yes.
The will of God is all encompassing.
Yes.
It is moving.
Yes.
It's all encompassing.
Yes.
It's all encompassing around your heart and the physical.
Yes.
Let's read.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's read. After these things, we're in verse 1. We're just going to read expositorily, please. And I think the Lord is just going to have us sit in chapter 15. I don't think we're going to go anywhere else, and that's fine with me. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham. The word of the Lord came unto Abraham in a vision. A spiritual thing took place, and he heard it in his heart, and he heard it in his, and he seen it in his eyes. It's a confirmation of two things. It's a bearing witness in the heart and in the eyes. This is not any lie that Abraham has seen. If you've seen something in your heart but you've not seen it manifested in the Spirit, make sure you have confirmation first of that.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Otherwise, you might just be divining something out of your own heart.
That's right.
Well, now.
Yep.
The Lord already.
Abraham in a vision saying, fear not, Abraham. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. You see, the first thing that the God, the Lord Almighty, wants to show Abraham is that he's got him. And not only does he have him, the very fact that he is there present and surrounding him is not only a blessing of protection, but it is a divine blessing of prosperity. I am your reward, saith the Lord. I am your portion, says God. Sister Cherie, you were talking about those cares this morning. About we're holding on to our portion of the world, and we've not got our portion in the Spirit. We want that earthly portion, because God has blessed us with prosperity and abundance in life, both in spiritual and in physical. But we got to remember that not only is he our reward, but he is our shield.
Yes.
Not only is he around us spiritually, because, see, God is a spirit. Right?
Yeah.
We see not God. Neither has any person seen his shape before. And blessed are those who have not seen. Blessed are you who have not seen. You're blessed. You're blessed. Who have not seen his fall. Though we see it in part through the church, through the fullness of God working in throughout his people. But he's also the shield. The shield. And the reward. And Abraham said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me? Ain't that funny? He says, I'm your reward and your shield. And he says, okay, what are you going to give me? I need to see it, Lord. It's okay to remind God we need to see it. It's okay. God knows who he's dealing with. It's not anything God can't handle in your life. If you say, God, I need to see it. It's not the end of the world. Your faith might be lacking a little. God's understanding why so little faith. He's worked in these people before for thousands and thousands of generations. We're not anything different. Us standing up here, even a great man of faith, he's still got the same mustard seed we've got. He's just added to it. He's learned how to add to it. A great wise man in faith knows how to add to his faith. We talked about this in Bible study this past Thursday. We know how to add to our faith if we want to see the manifestation that God is promising us, saying he is our reward. But God, we want to see it. Where is this reward? He said, what will thou give me, seeing I go childless and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus, a Gentile? What will you give me, Lord? All my stuff is going to go to someone who has not even my name. He's a servant. Come on, y'all know how the story goes. Are we not Gentiles?
Yeah, we are.
Servants of God? Are we not Gentiles, servants of God? Can we not look at poor Abraham and see that there's a wanting of a lineage to go forth and a seed to go forth, our own seed? That's just something God put in us. We want that. It's an innate thing God's put in all men to see their line continue. It's because it's just the image of God. God wants his line to continue. Right? He wants his line to continue. This is nothing more than the image of God being displayed in a man who wants the same thing that God wants in his world. And Abraham said, behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thy own bowels shall be thine heir. He that comes forth from thy own bowels shall be thine heir. We want to leave a good life to our children. We want to leave a good life to those who we love. We want to leave the state behind us in a better state than we left. That's what we're called to do. But we want to make sure it's left to responsible people. We want to make sure it's left to people who are able to walk in the virtue, power, and wisdom for what you need. Solomon says one time in a place in Ecclesiastes, he says, I can build up all these treasures, but if they're left to an unwise man.
What?
If I just leave all these things to an unwise man, he'll just go. But it would just been in vain. That's why he says, everything's vanity. He just doesn't see the hope in it. But we have a better word.
Yes.
A better word.
Yes.
A greater word.
Yes.
Above every word.
Yes.
And so too, I urge you, brothers and sisters, mothers, fathers, the inheritance that God has left you, the inheritance that God has left you, are you growing in the wisdom and in the knowledge of God to be able to carry out that inheritance that he's given you? Because I think what we need to understand is that as we want the inheritance of God, which I don't think sometimes we fully understand what we ask when we say these things. That's why when John and his brother James says, oh, allow us, Jesus, Master, to sit one on your right hand and one on your left hand, he says, you don't know what you're asking for.
That's right.
You're not sure what you're really asking for. That's been prepared for those. I can't give that to you. That's been prepared by the word of the Lord. I shall be numbered with the thieves. I shall be numbered with the transgressors. He says, but you will. You will. Be careful what you ask for. You will drink of my cup and be baptized with the baptism I have out of it. Said the Lord. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. What a great promise he's given unto Abraham. Yeah. We're in that promise. That's where you can find yourself in the Word of God.
Yes, amen.
You want to find yourself in the Word of God right there. He says, your seed shall be this way. You are the seed of Abraham by faith.
Amen.
You are the seed of Abraham by faith.
That's right.
We're about to understand how so. By faith. Let's go on down a little bit. Verse 8. He says, I got to see something still, Lord. He says, and he said, Lord God, whereabouts shall I know that I shall inherit it? I need to see something, Lord. You're going to have to show me. You're going to have to show me. Because you promised something to me. And I need to make sure that I've got it. I need to make sure that I've got it. He said unto him, take me an heifer of 3 years old, and a she-goat of 3 years old, and a ram of 3 years old, and a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And he took unto him all these, and divided them in the midst, and laid them, and laid each piece one against another, but the birds divided eat none. And when the fowls came down upon the carcasses, Abraham drew them away. Now, if you're just reading Genesis, you can read through this passage. Through this part pretty quickly and just be like, okay, that's weird. And just keep on going. But you see, Abraham knew exactly what God wanted him to do, because at a time such as this in Abraham's day, if you wanted a covenant between someone, it's called a cutting of a covenant. And you would take these animals and you would split them in two, and you would walk between these two pieces, these two parts, and you would declare the promise that you were going to live by. And if not, that you should be like those two pieces that you were walking through if you did not uphold your promise. And he says, and when the fowls came down upon the carcasses, Abraham drove them away. You understand? When you are dying, when your flesh is failing, and I mean not in a failing as in you failed, I mean when you're putting down the old man, and that old man is dying away, and you're putting him off, that's when the vultures are going to come.
Yeah.
That's when the eagles will come. Jesus says, wherever the carcass is, that's where the eagles will gather. He says, these are the things you're going to look for in the end of the age. Wherever the dead man is, there the enemy will come and try to devour that, what you're trying to put down. And I think this congregation needs to know, I believe God is trying to tell each and every one of you, there is hardship going to be happening when you are putting down the old man, because the devil wants to bring him back up. Yes. And you want to put him down six feet under, as low as you can possibly go. Yes. And you want to get rid of him. You want to crucify him, because the commandment of the Lord says, crucify your flesh.
Yes.
If you want to follow me, crucify him. You think the devil is unaware of this commandment given unto you? No, he knows exactly what you're going to do. He knows exactly that you want to crucify. He knows exactly that you've got the Spirit of God upon you. He knows exactly that the Lord is your shield and your portion, and he wants to rip it up and give it to some other person. Yes. He wants to give it to another kingdom. He wants to give it to his kingdom. Yes. He wants to give it to the kingdom of darkness, those children of disobedience and follow after the way of wrath. He wants that to be the inheritance and not you.
Yep, that's right. The word.
Amen.
The vultures will come.
Amen.
The demons will come.
Yep.
The principalities will try to rule over you.
Yep, right.
Fear not, little flock.
Yep.
The Lord is in control of all these things. He is the sovereign Lord.
Yes.
He is the sovereign Lord. Come on, he is the sovereign Lord.
Yes.
Come on, give him some praise.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Our God.
That's right.
And when the sun was going down, verse 12,
deep sleep fell upon Abram. The load of war, great darkness fell upon him. Horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Suppose you, this darkness, as he's tried to enter into this covenant with God, suppose you, this darkness is something that we experience too as we try to enter into a covenant with God. Suppose every night that the sun goes down on us, that's when these vultures come. Suppose when the sun is setting, suppose when the spiritual world is getting dark and darker and darker, suppose that's when a great horror comes upon us and we see things we don't want to see. We see things that we're not fully prepared to see. So I think what Abraham is about to witness is something truly satisfying yet horrifying.
Horror is the word. Horror.
He's seen something scary, but he also seen something that he could stand by and walk in faith with God, because we know after this he continued to walk with God. So suppose, brothers and sisters, that when these times in our life come, these seasons in our life come, when we're trying to put the old man down, we're trying to hold on to the covenant of God and see what he's going to do in our lives. Suppose, brothers and sisters, that when a darkness falls upon us, should we look? Should we look for what the Lord is doing? Should we look and look? He says, and he said to Abraham, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land. Here it is. Is not theirs, verse 13, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. Y'all know Abraham oppressed an Egyptian slave, right? We have Ishmael, the descendants of Ishmael, because of his oppression over Hagar, the stranger. It's literally what her name means, the immigrant, the stranger. And now God says, you're going to have to answer for that. But not only you, but your children are going to have to answer for that. And it is my sovereign will that it will be done. And I'm telling you right now, Abraham, your children, your descendants will go into a land that is not theirs. And guess what, Abraham? It's going to be the same nation that you oppressed in that one individual. We have to answer for our sin.
Yes.
It's not pretty when God makes us answer for our sin. When we have to confess it to Him, when it has to be brought to our face, we don't fully like to see it, but it's easier enough just to get it out of the way. But I tell you, there's an even greater news, brothers and sisters. There's even greater news than what Abraham had. They shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance.
Yes.
He's our reward. He's our shield. We might have to face the consequences of what we got, but when we persevere with diligence, endurance, this affliction, we will come through with great substance.
Yes, amen.
With riches according to the glory of God.
Yes, His glory.
Riches according to His glory. You know, sometimes you might be praying for finances, and sometimes you might be praying for knowledge and wisdom. Sometimes you might be praying for a new car. Sometimes you might be praying that your feet stand firmly upon the rock. Sometimes you want to see a great physical substance given unto the children of God, because you're tired of seeing destruction, wickedness. You're tired of seeing these things in your life and those around you. You're tired of seeing people burdened, carrying around yokes, in bondage to things that they shouldn't be in bondage of. I'm tired of seeing the children of God, those who profess the name of Jesus, in bondage and addiction to something in their lives.
Amen.
I mean, anything. I know we're not under the law, but
Romans says we establish the law through faith because we want to please God. Those who please God have to please Him in faith. And so, when you find yourself under these addictions, these things, realize that the commandment of God that you've broken is you've created a God for your own self that is okay with what you're doing. You've created a God in your own image that's okay with what it is you're trying to do. And sometimes what God is doing in your life can be a little bit horrifying. Sometimes the darkness can go upon you because God wants to show you something. But He says, I am your reward.
Yes.
And you will come out of this with great substance if you just persevere and endure.
Yes.
And what are we to endure? Paul says, endure the afflictions of the gospel.
Yes.
And sometimes that is a physical infirmity. Sometimes that is a servant of Satan coming to oppress you in a way that you don't understand. Sometimes it is a person of wrath come against you that Satan has raised up and has spoken evil and lies to. But sometimes the afflictions of the gospel are letting go of the things of the world, though it may afflict your flesh.
Yes.
Because your flesh thirsts and hungers to be filled by the world. Because you are of the world. But not anymore, because you are of Christ.
Sure.
You're not of the world anymore. You are one spirit with God. You are betrothed to Him. To be one with Him in His kingdom. To be one with Him in His sanctuary where He ministers forever.
Yes.
By His blood, by His spirit, by His power, by His authority, by His sovereignty, which is control of all things. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace. Thou shalt be buried in a good old age, Abraham. But in the fourth generation they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. The way God works in the lives of the church, in the lives of His children, in the lives of His sons and daughters, is also to put down the wickedness in the world, to speak out against it in truth. He says, because when you come out with great substance, because that's what you're going to need when you come out of this situation, brothers and sisters, that you find yourself in. When you come out of this with great substance, He says, I am your shield. I am your reward. You see Abraham come out of a great situation where he had to go in and rescue his nephew Lot. And he wasn't sure what might happen, but he knew that God was his shield and his exceeding great reward because the word of the Lord had come to him and reminded him, that's what I am. I am that thing that you have experienced. And I'm confirming it with my word. And so when you come out of these dark situations with a great substance, it's so that you can put down the wickedness that is at its fullness, because the fullness of the church is coming, where it will put down the wickedness of this world and it will stand on a firm rock. And those who are chosen, those who are elected by God, are foreknew and ordained as the foundation of the world, you will stand with God with great substance, both in the physical and the spiritual, because it is not just a promise in the eternal, but it is a promised land. You're not just getting a new heaven, you are getting a new earth. You're not just getting a new spirit, you are getting a new body. You're not just getting all these things that you think in the spiritual and not in the physical. You're getting both of these things.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Great, brother.
Yes, Jesus.
And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, it's just a retelling of what just happened. It's just a retelling. The sun went down to his darkness, and it came to pass the same day, Lord, or it came to pass when the sun went down and it was dark. Behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between the pieces. This is a confirmation. A furnace, smoking furnace. It goes first in this sequence of events. See, it's a smoking furnace, and then a burning lamp, and the word of God. You will This furnace that it speaks of, we've been revealed in Scripture, it is a furnace of affliction. It is a furnace of affliction, a smoking furnace. We all know the old story of Daniel, right? Yeah. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Mm-hmm. They went into that furnace.
Yes, they did.
Because they stood for the word of God. They stood not against God, but would not bow to the image of man. You understand, that is how Satan uses us in this age. He uses the children of wrath as an image. He upholds the image of man that it might be worshipped. That's why we are to dress and walk in humility, that we might not be of reputation. Jesus came and made himself of no reputation. Jesus came that nobody would even look upon him and say, that's the king.
Yeah.
In Isaiah, it says that he wasn't a man that walked with beauty as one would in the world think beauty. He was just a common man. God came in that same image that he is. See, God is not going to force you to walk in his covenant, because he's not going to make himself of any reputation to you, because he needs not that any man should testify of him, and he does not receive honor and glory from man. We can say bless God all day long, and that is our reasonable service, but he doesn't need it. He says, I don't need honor from you. I don't need your opinion of me. That doesn't hinder me where I'm going. My face is towards the mark, the high calling of God, where I'm going to be lifted up into glory. I don't need any reputation. I'm going to change the world in the most upside down way anybody can. I'm going to suffer for it. I'm going to suffer affliction. I'm going to suffer the affliction of the furnace. That's why in Revelation it says, I looked upon his feet and it was like bronze from this burning furnace. Because he had suffered affliction. And who are the hands and feet of God? Hallelujah. You think that that's not a revelation of what you're going to experience? Amen. Count it all as joy, said the Lord. Count it all as joy.
Amen.
Count it all as joy. It says, a burning lamp that passed between the pieces. Hebrews says that God, there's no greater thing than God. And when someone makes a covenant or a promise or swears, they swear by something greater than themselves. That's why Jesus says, let your nay be nay and your yea be yea. How many times have we told somebody we'll do something and we don't do it? I know I'm one of them. We told somebody we'll be there, we'll do something, we don't do it. Let your nay be nay and yea be yea. Walk in the presence. Walk with God. With now. I am now. Walk with God. And whatever he speaks, you speak. Whatever he does, you do. You are his reflection. You are his image. Walk in that same no reputation. But see, there's something that we should know about this covenant. God says there's no greater than me. And see, what I'm going to have to show you, Abraham, and I'm going to have to show your children, is I'm going to have to swear by my own self. Because there's nothing greater than me. This lamp that goes through the pieces is the Spirit of God. When John looks in the sanctuary of heaven in the book of Revelation, he sees the seven spirits of God presenting themselves as a lamp. Seven lamps. Not to say God is seven different spirits, but to say God is a deep completion, a fulfilling of all things, in all things, because he was in creation, through creation, speaking into creation, and that word still holds all things together. That word holds us together. That word holds us in unity. It is the seven Spirit of God, all the wisdom, all the knowledge, the truth, the blessing, the grace, humility, the love, the fruit that God is bringing up in the church. That is what is passing through the pieces. That is what is passing through you and I. And he says, I'm going to promise by my own son, Abraham. Abraham knew that there was a covenant made, and knew God was going to make it upon his own terms. Because let's face it, God didn't make the covenant on his terms. We want to know why God does certain things, why God requires certain things from us. It's because he's God and he can. But he's revealed to us in Scripture through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our only Master, our only God, the servant of servants, the Lord of lords, and the King of kings, that we ought to walk in that same light. Put down these things, brothers and sisters, that are holding you in bondage to earth. Put down these things that are keeping you away from God, and it would make yourself a present image above God. Suffer affliction. It's okay. Fast. Pray.
Yes.
Leave the things of this world behind.
Yes.
You know, these easy things. Smoking, drinking, lying, stealing, cheating, murdering, thieving. These are the big. But once God gets you in that, he says, now I want to sanctify you. I want to sanctify you. Let God sanctify you. Let go of the things of this world that you might see the great reward and the portion of God. That you might see the covenant of God clearly in your life. That he is passing through. And that he has done it on his own terms. By his own flesh. By his own blood. Which is shouting greater things in us this day.
Yes.
A greater, more righteous than anything that we could ever imagine. And out of the abundance we give.
Yes.
Out of the abundance we give. That's the reason why Abel's sacrifice was held in high esteem and not Cain's. Cain's was out of the things that he had plenty of. But Abel had to sacrifice a living being. It was honorable. It's something he worked for and seen grow, take life and birth in the world. Some of these works that we give God, and we're birthing them into the world, and we're seeing and that by our hand is coming to pass. Sometimes we have to give those things up to God. It's a more honorable sacrifice when we give all of our living. When we give all that we have to God, when we give all that we want to God, and not hold on to it any longer. This is why the widow with two mites was honored more than those who gave out the abundance they had in the temple. Now follow me. He said, in the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, Unto thy seed have I given this land. And there's that physical confirmation from the river Egypt. So the same place your people are going to be oppressed in, I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to give you the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates, unto something that you came from, and unto something even greater, the great. So too, we have that promise. We have a promise of a promised land. We have a promise of a great river, a flowing river that we can jump in and flow with and follow anytime. That we can bask in, bathe in, clean in, soak in each and every day, and be reminded of the promise of God that's coming to us. Though we've not seen it, though it's not been portrayed to us as it had for Paul, or had been for Peter and the apostles, he says, you've been given and have obtained this life, precious faith. We talked about this in Bible study now. Divine nature. He says, I'm giving it to you. And I'm giving it to you. And the only way I know how, I'm going to give you myself. Because there's nothing greater than me. And I want what's best for you. And I want you to have great things.
Yes.
I want you to have a great ring.
Yes.
I want you to have a great substance.
Yes.
So I'll leave you to this.
Jesus came that we might look upon him as a man of no reputation, a man that was God, a man that was man, and a man that showed himself and revealed scripture to us and revealed his word to us and revealed the covenant to us that he promised by his only self. And he asked us to do the same. If we suffer with him, we will reign. I thank you for listening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Awesome words.